I'm Jenna Bonnoy, and I'm here at one of the most animated places in the world, Mickey's Toontown in Disneyland. You know, some pretty famous Disney characters live here in Toontown, and one of them is now starring in his first full-length movie. It features not only his comic ability and his acute sense of timing, but his dramatic ability as well. Who is this great comic actor? Well, here's a hint. He's tall. He's dark. He's hands-on. He's Goofy. So, sit back and get ready to experience a great new Goofy, his son Max, and one heck of a crazy adventure as we go behind the scenes into the making of a Goofy movie. Pound for pound, there's no other dog quite like Goofy. He's a champion to the silly, a hero to the stumblers, and a figurehead to all that is pure, simple, and, well, Goofy. As he launches his first full-length feature, you'll see Goofy as you have never seen him before. Sure, he's still the lovable Goof we all respect and admire, and he still pretty much looks the same, too. But when you add his wannabe cool son, Max, to the movie, the results are a father and son adventure that is guaranteed to blow your socks off. In a Goofy movie, Goofy and his son Max take a wild car trip across the country to see some of the places Goofy saw when he was a kid.
Oh, boy!
The only problem? Max isn't really interested in bonding with his dad.
What the heck you trying to do?
Trying to get away from you.
In fact, he's absolutely terrified of growing up to be just like him.
There, I was,
Add to the mix Max's crush on a cutie named Roxanne. Goofy's neighbor Pete and his son PJ.
My dad is gonna smash me like a bug.
And a cast of high school kids.
Look, it's the Leaning Tower of Cheesa. Huh.
One whose voice should sound quite familiar.
So my theme's gonna be Powerline Goes Rainforest.
And it's also got a cool new soundtrack with new music featuring Tevin Campbell. Put this all together with lots of action-packed scenes filled with close calls, narrow escapes, even Bigfoot, and you've got the makings of what's destined to be another classic Disney comedy. But wait a minute. Family problems, rock and roll, and Bigfoot? Goofy's life wasn't always this complicated.
Many famous celebrities view success as a chance to put their handprints in cement. Well, I guess Goofy's been making impressions for as long as most people can remember.
Goofy first appeared in a Disney animated short back in 1932 as Dippy Dog, a minor character who was seen for only a few moments as a laughing member of the audience. Truth is, that might have been it for old Dippy Dog. See, as far as featured characters went, Mickey already had a full-time dog named Pluto. But by 1935, Walt Disney began to realize Dippy Dog's potential. Dippy was a genius at taking the simplest tasks and making them almost impossibly difficult. It was at that point that Walt Disney himself changed Dippy's name to Goofy, an appropriate name for a dog with such crazy antics. Goofy's climb to stardom had begun. Goofy's simple and honest nature, as well as his ability to really goof things up, made him a natural for Disney how-to sport films. First, Goofy attempted fishing in On Ice. Then Goofy tried hunting moose with his pal Donald Duck. Then duck hunting, this time without Donald for obvious reasons.
Hey!
Goofy even tried skiing and self-defense, baseball, golf, gymnastics. And dancing. He definitely had the legs for dancing. Goofy also proved to be a war hero. During World War II, Goofy did his part by teaching how to be a sailor. And by showing off victory vehicles.
And following the war, Goofy taught people how to drive and how not to drive in Motor Mania. Freeway Phobia and Goofy's Freeway Trouble. Sports legend, war hero, and even a great humanitarian, it seems only fair that Goofy would finally get a movie. With a career in comedy that spanned over half a century and never run out of gas, the old Goofster's ready, primed and ran to shift gears into a world of full-length feature films. Of course, with a guy like Goofy driving, it takes a lot of people to keep a Goofy movie on track.
This studio has been trying to do a contemporary version of a classic character in different formats, in TV and shorts, and this is probably their first real theatrical attempt at it.
The task of turning a classic character like Goofy into the first full-length feature of its kind began with the most important element of all.
In the Disney approach to feature animation, story is preeminent. Nothing is more important than story.
And the story is about the relationship of a father and a son. A father who's worried about his son and where he's going, and the fact that they don't get along, they don't communicate.
Everybody mumble! Boom, 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 boom.
Come on, there's no time for this. Max, Goofy's son. He's growing up. He doesn't want to be like his dad.
You look just like I did at your age.
Please don't say that, Dad.
It's not bad enough that you're 14-year-old and you got your dad hanging around. It's even worse. This time your dad is Goofy. Max goes to school.
Good morning, boys and girls.
And he does this stunt. Dad finds out about it through a telephone call from the principal.
Your son caused the entire student body to break into a riotous frenzy.
He gets scared to death that his kid's turning into a juvenile delinquent.
I'd seriously reevaluate the way you're raising your child before he ends up in the electric chair!
The electric chair? What am I gonna do?
And decides that the only way to solve it is to bring him on a cross-country vacation.
Why are you doing this to me, Dad?
Because I don't want you to end up in the electric chair.
This is a unique role for Goofy. I think it's gives him a much greater depth of character.
No matter how big you get, you'll always be my son.
Boom, in comes Bigfoot.
Brian Pimentel is head of story for a Goofy movie. It's his job to look at the entire script and then break it down into a series of sketched pictures called storyboards.
Well, usually you'll start with a screenplay. You'll probably just first, you know, read through the script and then just start visualizing in your head. You would present it to the director and act it out a little bit. Is it gone yet? From there, you'll start drawing it out panel by panel.
They spend a lot of time making sure that the boards and what appears on the screen is really right. And there's big evolution between the script and what you finally see.
At the same time the story is being ironed out, artists are designing the different characters needed for each scene.
They have a vague idea of what the characters are. The character designer just basically makes a person out of them.
Carol's design was based on a sketch made by the director.
Kevin, for example, wanted a character who was 13 years old and spunky and the most popular girl in the school.
As the characters begin to take shape, actors are brought in to perform the voices.
Don't worry, he'll be there.
Your principal called me!
Professionally, I've been Goofy for about 8 years. Pinto Colvig, who was an original circus clown and started the company with Walt, did Goofy's voice from 1932 in Mickey's Review. For the first year of doing the voice, I listened to tapes of Pinto do Goofy and everything, and it was an impression. After about a year, I made it my own. And I could do it now in my sleep. Yeah, it's a job.
I better be going.
I'll call you later.
It's okay, folks. I was just acting.
Actor and voice talent Jason Marsden was cast as the voice of Max.
Basically, they wanted a voice much like mine, not like a cartoony type voice, not like a goofy type voice. Just basically my voice up a little bit in octave and, you know, crack here and there and lots more energy.
Yes! She said yes!
High five, son! Psych!
You had such a way with children.
Pete, well, he's father of the year.
If you keep them under your thumb, they'll never end up in the gutter.
The worst neighbor you'd ever have in your life. The worst husband and father that you could ever imagine. You gotta love this guy. He's not warm and cuddly. He might be warm, but he's definitely not cuddly. I think he's basically there to make sure that Goofy's life is that of pain and agony. And it's... And we like that.
Max!
Hey!
Whoa! Small wilderness, dude! Didn't expect to run into you.
PJ is a really hip kid in a very unhip bod. And it's just sort of a genetic predisposition.
Come on, it was really stupid.
I thought that might be, you know, if I put the voice back here, it might give him a little sort of more girth, you know?
I just heard about you and Roxanne.
You can go, oh, Max, don't be such a jerk, man. Come on, Roxanne loves you, you know?
But that's, if I make it more like this, then it doesn't give it so much girth. It sounds smaller. Not to say that you can't have a hefty person that talks like this, but I think this is more effective, personally.
One thing an actor quickly realizes when doing character voices for a Disney film, he's going to have fun.
And the crowd goes wild. Psych!
The thing I think about when I'm performing, Pete, is I don't think. I just let it pour out. You just look for the humor in the scene. Because it can't just be just mean. You know, he's got to be mean with a heart or mean with a smile on his face, so to speak.
Everybody mumbo! Just a lot of fun. You know, you don't have to, you know, get dressed up, you know, to come into work. It's also a lot of using your imagination.
The most fun, I think, is being a part of sort of the whole Disney mystique. You pull into the gate on your first visit here, and they say, okay, you've got to walk down Donald Duck Way to Dopey Drive, and then you hang a left on Minnie Mouse Lane, and it's really, you're going, man, this is really cool.
It's basically all the things that used to get me kicked out of class when I was a kid I get to do now for a living, and they pay me to do it, so... Can't beat that.
Once the voices have been recorded and the storyboards are complete, they are given to the animators to begin work. And to further guide the animators, the director gives his ideas.
I actually go through the storyboard frame by frame and talk about what I want from the acting of the piece. So I'll get up there and I'll do Goofy's voice and I'll do Bigfoot and all that kind of stuff and basically act out the scenes.
Acting is something the animators are very used to. In fact, they too consider themselves actors. It's their job to take the ideas of everyone before them and turn them into movable drawings on paper.
You have to know and think about how the acting and observe how people act or how animals act.
There's a difference between making something just move or just putting a drawing on a piece of paper and making something live. If you love people and you watch them and you see these little things that they do and you're able to put that in your work.
Can you go back and watch it again?
As different animated sequences are completed, it is then the director and producer's job to review these scenes and make changes as they are needed.
One, two, here we go.
In a Disney animated film, music is used to help move the story forward and to help us understand what the characters are feeling. And in a Goofy movie, there were 6 original songs.
Well, when we first started and we had our basic story, we sat down with composers and talked about how to musicalize the story and place the songs within the piece.
With this project, we were writing strictly on a theatrical basis, which is to say that each song helps to develop the character of the person singing it, and also in some way furthers the action of the storyline.
Me and Max relaxing like the old days.
Stand dragging breath and
acting. In a buddy kind of
mad. I think I may
when
explode.
When I see that highway, I could cry.
You know, that's funny, so could I just be
out on the open road.
This is pretty early on in the trip, and Goofy's thrilled to be out on the road. And so it's a duet that says, from Goofy's point of view, isn't it great to be out in the road? And if the world is getting you down, why don't you forget your troubles and get out on the open road?
And from Max's point of view, when he sings his part of the duet, it's like he's completely exasperated with the situation and thinks this is terrible.
We have songs that are character-driven, much like the classic Disney films. And we have songs that are much more moment-driven, like there's a concert in the film, and there are songs in the concert.
There's a character named Powerline in the movie, who's a rock star at that. Max, it's his hero. He listens to his music. So we had to go and create original music that would service the story, that would feel like a contemporary rock hit.
Rhythm and blues performer Tevin Campbell was brought in to give all of Powerline's songs the upbeat rock feeling they were looking for.
And they showed me all the things that they were doing and what they wanted me to do and all the sketchboards. Then I went into the studio after that and did the songs. When the Eye to Eye scene, me as Powerline.
It's a piece of cake.
Me and Goofy and Max, we all meet up together on stage and we sing the song together as I'm performing on stage.
If we listen to each other.
It's really fast up-tempo. I've never done anything this fast before.
This was also Tevin's first time acting in a Disney animated film. A Goofy movie was the perfect choice.
Goofy is one of my favorite Disney characters. He's one of the funniest ones. When I watched him as a little kid, he would make me laugh. Everyone could go around and imitate Goofy. It's definitely fun. It's definitely an experience. I want to take it further maybe one day.
And who sang the songs for the other characters? In some films, other actors are brought in specifically to sing. When it came to Goofy, however, Bill Farmer was chosen to do both.
No one else can sing that bad.
Who deserves a hero's trophy as we face each catastrophe? Nobody else but you.
Creating the right music for all the characters in a Goofy movie was one unique challenge, but it was nothing like the long-distance hurdle waiting just across the sea.
A Goofy movie est aussi très original à cause du fait que l'animation du film a été faite en France avec des animateurs de partout dans le monde. Cela, bien sûr, a posé beaucoup de problèmes.
That's kind of hard to understand if you don't speak French, isn't it? Well, you could just imagine all of the interesting situations that came about when the Disney studio decided to produce a significant portion of the animation of a Goofy movie at their other studio in France. That's right, an American story animated 5,600 miles away. Boy, this is kind of a bumpy ride.
S'il te plaît, arrête le train, j'ai la tête qui tourne.
That means stop the trolley, I'm getting dizzy. Goofy, could you just slow down just a tiny bit? You know, it's sort of bumpy.
We're always looking for where is there a great talent pool, and we felt France had it.
This studio went over to France and England and set up two studios to do DuckTales the movie, and the decision to keep that one crew in France working for 2 years until the next property came along, and it was decided that we were going to continue making animated features.
They have a high level of craft over there. French cartoonists are extremely proficient. They're tremendous panache and style to their drawing.
Maybe France was the perfect place to produce the animation, but problems do arise when your animators aren't working right next door on Dobie Drive.
They start working with faxes, with phone calls, with tapes that we're sending back and forth to California. And every week the animators were sending the tape so that Kevin can look at them and give the corrections.
We talk here at about 9, it's there 6 o'clock at night. So we do phone calls every single morning or every other morning.
So it's a lot of communication back and forth and a lot of patience by a lot of people on the project to try to work this way.
How do you convey comedy when you can't even speak the same language?
Yes, the language barrier was another problem to overcome. Not everybody speaks Goofies.
We need to do more of an open mouth shape instead of a little because, you know, we Americans talk like this with big mouth shapes.
Yes, you know? I know, I knew you are trying to always speak like this with your little mouth.
Here we're having basically 25 animators or actors, and they're acting out these characters from all over the world. Many of them don't speak English, performing this character in these scenes.
The fellow I worked with, Stéphane Saint-Foix, he spoke like that much English, and I spoke that much French. And at one point, Max says, "You're such a goob."
What a goob.
The guy came over to me and he's like, "What's a goob?" And I'm trying to, like, explain, you know, what this goob thing is. And they're, like, staring at me.
They're very much into movement versus attitude. They're very much into flailing arms. A lot of the Roger Rabbit style, I think, comes from European animation. And we have to keep a certain amount of it because you're dealing with Goofy.
We discovered a lot of things as we went along. You discover things like lip sync. When they think of a sound, they think of different lip movements than we do.
Non, pas vraiment.
The problem was for lip sync, because in work it was really different to get the correct pronunciation, because they were not used to speak English, so it was difficult for them to get the real accent.
Every country is different in very small details. How we move our cheeks, how we raise our eyebrows, what expressions we use, how we move our bodies around, how close we sit to people, how much, what it means when we bump into each other on the street.
There are many things that don't translate because they don't have the same cultural base. For instance, in Max's bedroom, when he wakes up in the morning, he has an alarm clock that's a digital readout. He's got gum and money, change, on the dresser. And we didn't realize until it got into color that the digits were like a French or a European clock, like a 24-hour clock. And the money was colored gold, like a French centime. And the gum looks like a typical brand of gum here. And we try to catch as many of those things as you can, but sometimes they just sort of sneak through.
And that's where the director comes into play. When all else seems impossible, the director is there to make sure everyone understands.
Goofy, c'est un personnage intéressant d'abord pour...
It was really interesting to work on Goofy because the way Kevin directs the movie with Goofy was really interesting. Because we had the Goofy that is naive, but also with his responsibilities of a father. So he was quite different.
Gosh.
Never had a problem dealing with the language.
On aura besoin de ce débattement, partant d'ici jusque là-bas, avec un changement de perspective, donc un niveau séparé, au sommet de la colline ici, elle disparaît derrière, l'animation des puits de pétrole, animé en cycle. Et qui viennent donc,
Kevin is a nice guy, but actually he had no idea of what he was talking about. As a whole, everything is okay with Kevin. The only thing is that he should improve his French.
Un travail surtout d'un...
At the time went by, the problem of communication was less important because people started getting concentrated on the movie, inside the movie, and this problem of language seemed less important because the acting, the animation was much more important and they managed to communicate.
But for most, learning a few words in French was well worth the chance to live in Paris.
Living in France was, of course, a great cultural boost. It's a beautiful city. I had a wonderful time sightseeing. I took many, many pictures, and I've got to see some of the finest museums in the world, and that can only help you as an artist. So I also learned how to eat cheese and drink good wine.
What exactly makes Goofy so popular? What warrants this comic legend getting his own movie?
Oh, Goofy's an everyman. He's totally optimistic. He rarely, if ever, gets mad.
He's a great comedic actor.
We all sit back and we laugh at Goofy.
We like him because he's a bit goofy, a bit naive, but he's got a big heart and he's really human.
He doesn't take failure. He laughs it off. He gets back up. He gets back on his feet, whether he fell off a mountain or off his roof or whatever. He shakes it off and goes back to it.
And maybe that's the secret to Goofy's success. Like so many of us who stumble our way through the challenges of everyday life, Goofy simply tries to do the best he can. And perhaps when we look at ourselves in the mirror, we can gain comfort in knowing that maybe, if Goofy can do it, so can we. I think it's safe to say that we're all a little goofy inside. I'm Jenna Von Oy. For myself and for Goofy, thanks for watching and au revoir.